Hi everyone! Welcome back to my channel. Today we're going to learn one of the most powerful features of ASP.NET Core, Dependency Injection. If you've ever wondered how Dependency Injection works or how to use it effectively in your .NET applications, this video is for you. Before diving into Dependency Injection, let's first understand what a dependency is. A dependency is an object that another object relies on to perform its functions. For example, a car class that requires an engine to function. In this case, the car class is dependent on an instance of the engine class. These required classes are called dependencies. When the car class uses methods of the engine class, it is said to have a dependency on engine. In .NET, before we can use methods of other classes, we first need to create the object of that class. In this example, class car needs to create an instance of class engine. Here, the car class is responsible for creating all its dependency objects. Car and engine are tightly coupled, and this can be problematic and has several drawbacks. Think about it this way. If you want to replace engine with a different version, you'd have to manually modify the car class. This makes it much harder to switch components or extend functionality without changing existing code. When car directly depends on engine, testing becomes a challenge. You can't easily replace engine with a fake or mock version, meaning tests for car will always include engine. This makes unit testing more complex and harder to isolate problems. As the project grows and more dependencies are added, the car class starts handling a lot of object creation logic. This clutter makes the code harder to manage, update, and extend over time. So, how do we fix this? This is where dependency injection comes in. First off, what is dependency injection? Simply put, dependency injection, or DI, is a design pattern that helps in achieving inversion of control between classes and their dependencies. Instead of a class creating its dependencies, these dependencies are injected into it, which makes the application more modular and testable. Dependency injection in .NET is a built-in part of the framework, along with configuration, logging, and the options pattern. Why is dependency injection important? Well, it reduces coupling, enhances maintainability, and improves testability. Okay, let's jump into the code. Alright, so I've gone ahead and set up an ASP.NET Core Web API project here using .NET 9. First, I'm going to add a service class to our project. So, to start, I'm going to create a folder called Services in our project. Next, I'm going to add a class called RandomNumberService inside the Services folder. Alright, so inside the RandomNumberService class, we're going to create one method. It's a public method, and it's pretty straightforward. All it does is return an integer value. To start off, I'll set the return value to 0. So, our method will return 0, for now, until we add the logic to generate a random number. To hold the random number, I'm going to create a private, read-only variable called underscore random number. This will store the random number, so we can access it later in our method. Now, let's move to the constructor. Here's where the random number gets generated. In here, we're using the random class to generate a random number. We pass 1 and 100 to the next method, and it will give us a random number between 1 and 100. So, when an instance of RandomNumberService is created, it automatically generates a new random number and stores it in the underscore random number variable. Now, I'm going to set up our getNumber method to return the underscore random number that was generated earlier. And now, our RandomNumberService class is all set up. Next, I'm going to add a new web API controller to our project. I'm going to name the controller random number, and this is where we'll be accessing our random number service. I'll define our get endpoint, which will just return an OK result for now. Later on, we'll update this endpoint to actually return the random number from our random number service, but for now, we'll keep it simple with just an OK response. First, I'm going to show you how to create an object of random number service directly here in the controller without using dependency injection. Later, I'll update it to use dependency injection for a cleaner and more scalable approach. So, I'll create a private read-only instance of random number service here. This approach means that the random number controller is tightly coupled with random number service. Since we're directly creating the random number service instance here, the controller depends on it to function. This is fine for now, but later we'll improve this by using dependency injection to decouple them. I'll update the get endpoint to return random number service get number. So now it will actually give us the random number generated by the random number service. Now, let's run the application and see this in action. Next, in Postman, I'm going to send a request to our endpoint to see the result. And there you go. We got the response. And it's 22. Now, let's send a request again. And this time, we got 48. It generated the random number successfully, and looks like our endpoint is working fine. All right, now let's take things a step further and see how we can use random number service with dependency injection. Using dependency injection helps to decouple our classes, making the code more modular, flexible, and easier to test. Instead of directly creating an instance of random number service in the controller, we'll register it in the program.cs file and let the framework inject the service wherever we need it. This way, our controller doesn't need to know how the service is created, and it can focus just on handling the requests and responses. First, we need to register our service in program.cs. This tells the application that we want to use random number service with dependency injection. So, services in .NET can be registered with three different lifetimes: singleton, scoped, and transient. Singleton means a single instance of the service is created and shared throughout the application's lifetime. Scope means a new instance is created for each request. And transient means a new instance is created every time it's needed. All right, let's first register random number service as a singleton. This means that only one instance of random number service will be created and shared across the entire application. By adding builder services.addSingleton. And here, we need to specify our service name, which is random number service, so that the application knows which service we're registering. Now, let's access random number service from our controller. Instead of creating an instance manually, we'll use dependency injection to get the service. First, I'm going to remove the manual creation of random number service from our controller. Instead, I'll inject it through the constructor, which is the proper way to use dependency injection in .NET. Next, I'm going to update the get endpoint slightly. I'm going to return an anonymous object that contains a property called number1, which will be assigned the value from randomNumberService.getNumber. I'm also going to create another variable called _randomNumberService2 and inject it into the constructor. This way, we'll have two instances of random number service in our controller. Then, in the get method, I'll return both random numbers, one from _randomNumberService and another from _randomNumberService2. This will help us see how different service lifetimes work in .NET. I'll also rename _randomNumberService to _randomNumberService1 to keep things clear and consistent. Now, I'll inject _randomNumberService2 into the constructor, just like _randomNumberService1. This way, we have two instances of random number service, and we can compare how they behave based on the service lifetime. In the get endpoint, I'll now return a second property called number2 and assign it the value from _randomNumberService2.getNumber. All right, now let's run the application and see the results. Now, I'm going to send a request to the get endpoint in Postman and check the response. We got the response. Both number1 and number2 are 43. This confirms that our random number service is working as a singleton, since we registered it with @Singleton. The same instance is being used across the entire application. Let's send the request again and check the response. Again, we got the response, and both number1 and number2 are 43. Since we're still using the singleton lifetime, we're getting the same value from both services. Now, I'm going to make a slight change to our random number service by adding an iRandomNumberService interface. This will help us define a contract for the service, making the code more modular and easier to maintain. By adding the iRandomNumberService interface, we're making our code more flexible and easier to test. It decouples the service implementation, so we can swap it with a mock or another version when needed. Great for unit testing. Plus, it makes the code more maintainable, as changes to the service won't affect the rest of the app. Let's add the iRandomNumberService interface now. The iRandomNumberService interface will have the getNumber method, which defines the contract for getting the random number. Now, let's implement the iRandomNumberService interface in the randomNumberService. This means we'll make randomNumberService adhere to the contract we defined in the interface. Let's move the iRandomNumberService interface into a separate file to keep our project organized and clean. Now, I'm going to update the program.cs file and register the iRandomNumberService interface instead of directly registering RandomNumberService. Add Singleton iRandomNumberService, RandomNumberService. This registers the iRandomNumberService interface and maps it to the RandomNumberService implementation using Singleton Lifetime. Now, let's update the controller to use iRandomNumberService instead of directly using RandomNumberService. This way, the controller will depend on the interface, not the concrete implementation. I've also changed the constructor to inject iRandomNumberService instead of RandomNumberService. Let's run the application now and check if everything is working correctly with the changes we've made. I'm sending the request to the endpoint now. We got both number 1 and number 2 as 78. This means our changes are working correctly, and dependency injection with the interface is set up properly. Alright, now let's change the service lifetime to scoped instead of singleton and see how it affects the behavior. Scoped services are created once per request or per connection. This means that every time we make a new HTTP request, a new instance of the service will be created. So, if we use scope for random number service, each request will get a new instance of service, and the random number will be different for every request. Now, let's change from singleton to scoped. Instead of @singleton, we'll use @scoped method to register the service. No need to make any changes to the random number controller since it's already set up to use the interface. The only thing we're changing is the service registration in program.cs to use scoped. Let's run the application now and see how the changes work with scoped. I'm going to send the request to the endpoint now. We got the response, and number 1 and number 2 are both 58. Since we've changed the service to scoped, the value will be the same for the entire request. But when we make a new request, we get number 1 and number 2 as 18. This is because each request gets a new instance of the service due to the scoped lifetime. So, each time we send a new request, we get a different random number. Now, let's see how transient works. With transient, a new instance of the service is created every time it's requested, even within the same request. So, let's change the service lifetime to transient. Instead of @scoped, we'll use @transient method. This will ensure that a new instance of the service is created every time it's requested. Let's run the application and see how transient behaves. I just sent the request by clicking the send button in Postman. And we got the response. Number 1 is 20 and number 2 is 8. Let's send the request again. We got number 1 as 65 and number 2 as 79. Since we're using transient, a new instance of the service is created every time it's requested, even within the same request. That's why both numbers are different again. So, that's how singleton, scoped, and transient lifetimes work in .NET dependency injection. We saw how each one affects our service instances and response data. I hope this was helpful. If you enjoyed the video, don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit the bell icon so you don't miss future content. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Happy coding!